3, 2, 1.
Hey, welcome back to week two of your group. We're looking at the Sermon on the Mount, the longest recorded teaching of Jesus, and we're working our way through from the beginning to the end as Jesus is inviting people into a new way of living with each other and with God that we call the kingdom of Jesus. Now, last week we asked this question, and it's going to guide us going forward for the next several weeks, and the question is this: who is a good person, and how do you know if you're living a good life? What Jesus did was to use a very specific word to describe what was necessary to live this way. The word he said was righteousness, and we looked at the Greek word dikaiosune, which just simply means what it is that makes a person truly right or good. Now, people listening then, and those of us listening now, would know that there's two ways to approach and live life. The first way is there's a kind of righteousness that's all about what people see, it's how you appear, and if you follow all of the rules. That kind of righteousness doesn't really care at all about what's in your heart. Then Jesus came along and said there's a whole new kind of righteousness that comes through faith and belief in him, and then he puts his righteousness in us, and out of that overflow, we live a whole new way. We are becoming these good people that his life flows out of as he's changing us. So here's the question for the next several weeks. How would the good person live? And what would the good person do who lives in the kingdom of Jesus with this new heart of the king? And Jesus is going to present six real life circumstances, things that you and I face in a normal everyday life. And he's going to show us how all this works. So he's going to tell us the old way, and then he's going to talk about the response we could have if Jesus was king of our heart. Here's the first one, Matthew chapter 5, verse 21. He says, "You have heard," so we're talking about the old way, "you've heard that it was said to our ancestors, 'Do not murder,' and whoever murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you," and so now he's going to explain the new way, "I tell you, everyone who's angry with his brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Whoever insults his brother or sister will be subject to the court. And whoever says, 'You fool,' will be subject to hellfire." Now, Jesus mentions four words that lay out what I would call a progressive path that culminates in murder. Murder is one of the big commands that people had heard their entire life. It's the act of deliberately taking someone's life. And that's such a violation of God's commands in the highest order, because we believe, and the Bible teaches, that God is the creator of life, that he breathed his breath into the man. He placed his image inside of the man. And therefore, no one but God has the right or the authority to decide when a person lives or dies. And Jesus lays this out there to say that the old way of doing things starts here, and it's only concerned about don't murder or you'll get into trouble. Now listen, if we could just grasp that truth, I think we would agree that the world would be a whole lot better place. But then he goes to another level and he connects the dots to the deeper issues behind murder. And let me show you how all this plays out. You see, anger in itself is neither good or bad, but it's an alert that something's wrong. And sometimes anger is the right thing to do when it moves us to restore things to be right. I like this definition from Dr. Henry Cloud that helps us think about the negative side of anger when he says, anger is frustration at the fact that we are not God and we do not have control over reality. It's that response when we say, but I am right and I have a desire that I have something I want and you got in my way and you disrespected me. You stopped me from doing what I want or getting what I want. When we don't move past our anger and instead indulge it, it brings with it an element of self-righteousness. We choose to actively receive it and then we do something with it. And we will act on that rage when we can justify our mistreatment or our need to rectify a wrong. I mean, what we're seeing in our world today is that when nothing seems to be done, or at least done the way that we want about the injustices around us, our anger builds and then it breaks. And it's the same pattern that plays out with your friend or in your family as it is in our country. Now, Jesus is going to take it up another level to say that when we insult someone, specifically he has in mind the word haraka, which is a word that's literally formed from the sound you make clearing your throat so you can spit in someone's face. It's the deep anger that leads you to say, you don't matter, or you're not worth caring about. You're actually the lowest form of human life on the planet. If you've ever sat back and wondered how human rights have been violated and global atrocities have been committed, it happens when one group of people have convinced themselves that another group of people are actually not human. If we could begin to label people with words that are subhuman, then we can justify our mistreatment of those people in less than human ways. It happens in world wars, and it happens in relationships like marriage. When you treat the other with disrespect and sarcasm and condescension, name-calling, mimicking, eye-rolling, you convey disgust and superiority. Contempt says, I'm better than you, and you're lesser than me. And with long simmering anger and negative thoughts, we add words that are degrading, we can form an attack on someone's sense of self. You're nothing, so I will treat you as nothing. And Jesus singled people out for the highest penalty because when you do that to someone else, you're guilty of killing a soul. Now, he's not done yet, and he directs our attention further to this word fool, which is really a G-rated interpretation. The best way to understand it in our modern English world is more than just calling someone an idiot. You'd have to add a very flavorful and crass adjective to the front end of that. What happens to you, I don't care because you're nothing. And here's the progression Jesus has laid out. You can see it. I get angry when I can't do what I want or get my way. So I redefine you and who you are, and I make it easier and more justifiable to treat you in a way that marginalizes you, pushes you away, or completely destroys you. And Jesus says that is such a violation of a person's worth, an assault of the soul, that the punishment would justify hellfire. See, when you and I begin to treat people differently than the value God has placed on them, we're in real danger. It is just simply not possible for a person to live with an attitude like that towards people and be in harmony with the kingdom of Jesus. Now remember what we're going for. It's dikaiosune. No one can be right in this kingdom without heart transformation. So real quickly, and you'll have to think about this and maybe talk in your group. If you've been on the receiving end, right, you've been hurt, you've been assaulted, you've been wounded, you're going to have to acknowledge that and maybe even seek some help to process that. I would just say that Jesus wants you to bring all of that experience, all of that pain, all of that loss into the kingdom of Jesus and let the King transform your heart. For those of us on the other side who are the ones dealing with anger, like we're the ones hurting people, we're labeling people, our anger has pushed someone so far away and caused so much damage and hurt and distraction to who they are that you have ended their life. Let's go back to our definition of murder, that no one but God has the right or the authority to decide when a person lives or dies. Your action steps are to repent, to stop what you're doing and to turn around and go in the direction of Jesus. maybe you'll need to get some help as well and do some really hard work. But most of all, bring all of that and who you are into the kingdom of Jesus and let the King change your heart from the inside out. Murder is just the ultimate step on a road that's paved with stones of unresolved anger and contempt and malice. But maybe there's more than one way to kill someone. So let's ask ourselves, where have I been guilty of maybe taking life from someone? And where can I be actively bringing life to someone? See, we're going for the Dike Asune kind of life. Jesus living in me, doing a transformative work so that I can live as a good person. And it happens as he's king of my heart.